From the studios of Staten Island Community Television, you're watching In the Bleachers, the TV show for the world's most passionate sports fans. Hello and very happy President's Day evening to you, everyone. My name is Jaime Hixson. You usually see me here with my broadcast partner, Hector Boza. Unfortunately, Hector continues to battle multiple health issues, and he could really use your prayers at this time. So please contact him on Facebook if you want to send him some get well wishes. And as always, you can contact us on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and Snapchat if you have any show ideas that you want to share with us. And you can also contact us on Snapchat as well. And if you missed the show, you can also check out some of the reruns on our YouTube page as well as our Facebook page for the show. Now, speaking of sending out prayers, we want to send multiple prayers right now to the people in Parkland, Florida. This past Wednesday was St. Valentine's Day. What was supposed to be a day to celebrate love turned out to be a day of major tragedy. This past Wednesday, of a terrible, terrible situation took place at Marjorie Douglas High School in Parkland, Florida, which is in Broward County, Florida, about 50 miles north of Miami. A crazed gunman, Nicholas Cruz is the man's name, who just so happened to be a former student, wound up killing 17 people, 15 of which were teenagers. The other two had major connections with the sports landscape in South Florida. One of them just so happened to be the school's assistant football coach. Aaron Feiss was the man's name. As it turns out, Aaron Feiss was also the coach of one of the guys on the Chicago Cubs, Anthony Rizzo, who just so happened to be a Parkland native and a graduate of Marjorie Douglas High School. The other person who was a victim in the shooting was Chris Hixson. No relation to yours truly. Chris Hixson was the school's athletic director, and he also happened to be a member of the Navy Reserves. Our condolences go out to Chris Hixson and Aaron Feiss and all of the students who became victims of this terrible, terrible tragedy. The names of the students are as follows: Alyssa Alhadef, Scott, there was also Scott Beigel, who was a teacher at the school, Martin Angelano, there was also Nicholas Dworet, who just so happened to be a star swimmer for the school, and he had just accepted a scholarship to a major college in Indiana. Condolences also go out to Jamie Gutenberg, who was also one of the victims of that terrible, terrible tragedy. There was also Luke Hoyer, Kara Loughran, Gina Montalto, Joaquin Oliver, Elena Petty, who was also, if I'm not mistaken, a cheerleader for Douglas High, Meadow Pollock, Helena Ramsey, and Alex Schachter, as well as Carmen Shentrup, Peter Wang, and those are all of the names of the victims of this terrible, terrible tragedy. Just one day after the shooting, Anthony Rizzo of the Cubs returned to Parkland, Florida, and gave a very impassioned speech about his time in the school, about the time he graduated from the school, and about how that school made a part of who he is today. If this does not send a message that something needs to be done about the excess violence that is going on in this country, then I don't know what will. But all I can say is all of our hearts, all of our prayers, all of our condolences go to the victims of this horrific tragedy. Not only was there an assistant football coach and an athletic director whose lives were taken away for no reason, one of the students, Alyssa Alhadef, was a very accomplished soccer player. You'll have to excuse me if I'm a little shaken over this whole thing, because this marks four that I can think of, or maybe five, shootings that have taken place on school campuses in the last 25 to 30 years or so. As soon as I found out about this, the first thing that I thought of was Sandy Hook in Connecticut, Columbine High School in Colorado, and Jonesboro, Arkansas, all of which have fallen, all of whom their students have fallen victim to senseless acts of gun violence. If you or someone you know has been the victim of gun violence, then please, please do something to try and help the community cut down on these senseless acts of violence, because we cannot afford to lose any more of our young people than we already have. So with that said, I'm going to say to you, we are very happy that you could join us this evening. And also joining us on the other side of the glass is our dear friend Roman DeSimone, an audio guy extraordinaire, who, if I'm not mistaken, is a big fan of Formula One racing, correct? Yep, he just gave us the thumbs up. He's a huge Formula One racing fan. And I just wanted to acknowledge Roman on the other side of the glass, because he's been with us roughly a year or two, and he has done tireless work for CTV, and we are forever indebted to him for his work ethic and for his enthusiasm and exuberance for helping us out, not just on tonight's show, but on a lot of the productions that take place here at the station. So, as Roman gives us the thumbs up once again, we also want to remind you guys, since it is President's Day evening, it's also Black History Month. And as we know, Black history has produced some of the most vital and important individuals in Black history. And a lot of those have made their way through the sports industry as well. As a matter of fact, just recently, I watched an ESPN 30 for 30 special. It was actually an ESPN 30 for 30 short story that you can check out on their website, ESPN.com/30for30. And there was a really intriguing article, or ESPN short, 30 for 30 short, about Penn State University football. It's called We Are. It was just 7 short years ago that the sex scandal involving their former coach, Jerry Sandusky. Their former assistant coach, Jerry Sandusky, wound up breaking out on campus. Things got so messy and so dark for the entire campus that their legendary head coach, Joe Paterno, wound up being fired amid allegations that he covered up or tried to cover up the entire episode. As it turns out, Jerry Sandusky is now serving life in prison for multiple counts of sexual abuse, and Joe Paterno passed away in January 2012 after a long battle with cancer. Well, there was a terrific 30 for 30 short about what happened in the aftermath. The name of it is We Are. And as it turns out, there is a very historical significance about the origin of their famous chant, We Are Penn State. Many years ago, there was a famous African-American player that wound up suiting up for the Nittany Lions. And as it turns out, he was the man who became synonymous for that very famous chant, We Are Penn State. I'm going to see if I can try and find for you that famous article. I'm on ESPN's website right now, and we're going to see if we can try and bring that article up for you. In case you haven't seen any of their shorts, you can go to them at any time. They have tremendous stories about what happened. And we're going to see if we can find this right now. Up, oh, it's right here. A long time ago, this goes back to 1948. Back in 1948, there was a really popular football player in the Philadelphia in the Philadelphia area. Unfortunately, the name of the young man escapes me, but I'm going to see if I can pull up some of the aftermath of that article. In the meantime, just to give you the gist of the story, there was a very famous situation that took place on the Penn State campus. This goes back to 1948. There was a ball player from the Philadelphia area who became a very, very, very well-known prospect. And as it turns out, this young man wound up drawing interest from several major colleges, one of which was the University of Miami. At that time, 1948, major segregation took place in Miami and the entire state of Florida. Miami tried to recruit this young man to be their star running back. He was a running back prospect back in the day. Not even knowing that the young man was African American. And when this young man let the coaches at UM know he was an African American, Miami wanted nothing to do with him. And as it turns out, Penn State wound up recruiting him, and he became their star running back. And I'm seeing here that one half of Key and Peele, Keegan-Michael Key, is the narrator for this story. So Penn State wound up signing this young man to be their star running back. And ironically enough, Penn State wound up having a game at Miami in the late 40s and early 50s. Miami refused to play Penn State unless they left that young African-American ball player back at home. Well, as it turns out, the entire Penn State squad, composed predominantly of white players, made it loud and clear, we are Penn State. We're not going to go anywhere without him. And thus began the famous chant, we are Penn State. And as it turns out, this kid wound up having a fantastic career playing running back for the Nittany Lions. He played all 4 years with them and had a terrific career, and he wound up being drafted later on into the NFL by the Detroit Lions. So, the moral of the story is this. Football, just like life itself, is a brotherhood. Whatever background you're from, whatever your heritage is, whatever race you may be, whatever color your skin is, we are all the same. In fact, in my eyes, there's never been any black or white. There's only been red, because red is the color blood that we bleed. Wally Triplett was the name of the Penn State player in question. He played for the Nittany Lions from 1945 to 1948. And he wound up having a very successful career with the Nittany Lions. As a matter of fact, I think he might have been the first black player to ever suit up for Penn State. And he might have been the first African American to be drafted into the NFL. He wound up being drafted by the Lions in 1949. He had a very short career. He only lasted barely two seasons. But the impact that he had on the Penn State campus can be felt more than 60 years later. And that's why I bring up the name Wally Triplett. Wally Triplett wound up being the first African American to be drafted into the NFL and also the first African American to play college ball at Penn State. And there were so many great, great players to come out of Penn State. They've earned the nickname Linebacker U because they've produced so many tremendous linebackers at the university, from Jack Ham to Paul Posluszny today. And with this being President's Day and Black History Month, I figured I'd help run down some of the other African-American athletes that made a major impact in the sports scene. Wally Triplett became one of them. And not too far from now is the NBA All-Star Game. And another guy who wound up making a major impact in the game of basketball is Earl Lloyd. Earl Lloyd became the very first black player to be drafted into the NBA. Lloyd, if I'm not mistaken, wound up playing, I have his bio over here. He wound up playing college ball at West Virginia State. And he wound up being drafted in 1950 by the old Washington Capitals. And after serving some time in the Army because of the Korean War, Earl Lloyd wound up playing 9 NBA seasons with the old Washington Capitals, and then he played 6 years with the Syracuse Nationals, who you now know as the 76ers, then spent 2 seasons with the Pistons. Just looking at some of the stuff that we have over here. Earl Lloyd wound up being drafted. Well, as it turns out, Earl Lloyd was the first player drafted into the NBA, but as it turns out, the very first black player, in fact, Lloyd, Chuck Cooper, and the former Harlem Globetrotter, Nat Sweetwater Clifton, who went on to play for the Knicks, became the first 3 African Americans to play in the NBA. This was 1950. Chuck Cooper played college ball at Duquesne, and then for West Virginia, and also for West Virginia State, And then he wound up having a six-year career with the Celtics, the Hawks, and the Pistons. And Sweetwater Clifton, in addition to playing for the Harlem Globetrotters, played for the Knicks. And he wound up helping the Knicks go to three consecutive NBA finals in the early 50s. Now, as far as who the first black NFL player was, we mentioned before that it was Wally Triplett. Well, as it turns out, Wally Triplett was the first guy to be suiting up for Penn State. The very first African-American in the NFL turned out to be Kenny Washington. Kenny Washington turned out to be the first black player in the NFL, and not Wally Triplett. I apologize for that mistake. But Wally Triplett was the first player to suit up for Penn State. Kenny Washington became the very first African-American to go into the NFL, and he paved the way for so many guys to make their way into the NFL. Now, obviously, we know the story of Jackie Robinson. Jackie, of course, became the first to break the color barrier in Major League Baseball. But a lot of people do not know who the first black man was to play professional baseball in general. There was a guy named Fleetwood Walker, Moses Fleetwood Walker, who became the first black player in organized professional baseball. And he wound up passing away in 1924. And as it turns out, he wound up making his debut 63 years before Jackie Robinson made his debut in Major League Baseball. In 1884, Fleetwood Walker became the very first black player in organized baseball. Now, you're probably wondering, have there been many African-American hockey players? Turns out, the answer is yes. And I'm going to look that up for you right now. Willie O'Ree. Willie O'Ree, who, by the way, is now 82 years old, was born in New Brunswick, Canada, and he has the distinction of being the NHL's very first hockey player. In fact, he wound up being called up to the Bruins, ironically enough, many years ago. He made his debut in 1958 for the Bruins against the Canadiens. And 3 years later, wound up playing just over half the season with the Bruins. And he wound up playing parts of two seasons in the NHL with the Bruins. He also made his mark in the World Hockey League, which was many, many years ago, and also played a little bit in the Quebec Hockey League and in the EPHL. Most of his career was spent in the WHL, and he wound up playing 45 games over two seasons with the Bruins. But the impact that Willie O'Ree made in the sport of hockey has now become twofold to this day, because the NHL more and more has become littered with really good black superstar players in the NHL, one of which is P.K. Subban, who is now with the Nashville Predators. Another guy who made his mark in the sports world, and this goes back to the 19th century, is Jack Johnson. Jack Johnson turned out to be the very first black heavyweight champion in professional boxing. Unfortunately, his life and career was marred because of numerous allegations of him running a prostitution ring across the country. But the impact that he made in the sport of boxing will never, ever be forgotten. In fact, he was the subject of a very famous movie that came out in the early 70s, The Great White, I think it was The Great White Hope, which starred the famous actor James Earl Jones, who's best known for playing or voicing the role of Darth Vader in the Star Wars trilogy. Well, James Earl Jones played a version of Jack Johnson in this film, and it was a terrific film that I wound up seeing many years ago. One other person that can never be forgotten is Althea Gibson. Althea Gibson became one of the first black female tennis players on the circuit, and she wound up winning numerous Grand Slam titles. And of course, on the men's side, there's Arthur Ashe. Arthur Ashe became the first African-American to win the U.S. Open. And both of those tremendous stars wound up having a major impact in the game, so much so, they wound up paving the way for the Williams sisters to make their mark in the game. Serena, a lot more so than Venus. Although Venus has had a terrific career, Serena has just dominated the game, and she just recently returned to the game after taking time off to have a baby. But this just goes to show you how big the sports world has been because of African-American and other black athletes. Nowadays, it seems like 90% of the NBA has been made up of black players. I would say 70 to 80% of the NFL also made up of black players. Unfortunately, we are not seeing the same thing happen in baseball. Whereas in baseball, 60% of the game is being played by white players, another, I'd say, 20 to 30% or so is being made up of Latinos, be it from South America or the Caribbean. And then you have guys making the way in from Japan and Korea and Taiwan. The last I checked, less than 10% of major league players in today's game are made up of African-American ballplayers. This at a time when so many guys are playing football and basketball, it seems like baseball has become the forgotten sport among African-Americans to try and play, either on the playgrounds or in school. Back in 1947, Jackie Robinson became the first African-American to make his way into the major leagues. And he started, unwittingly started, a pipeline for other African-Americans to make their way from the Negro Leagues, where the game was really prospering, into the majors. Larry Doby, first black man in the American League, won a championship with the Indians, won two pennants with them in 1948 and 1954. Willie Mays, an outstanding career with the Giants and the Mets. Some say he might be the greatest player of all time. Roy Campanella led the Dodgers to a pair of pennants. Actually, he wound up helping the Dodgers win, I think, four or five pennants and their only championship in Brooklyn. Don Newcomb, their teammate on the Dodgers. Also, Henry Aaron, who wound up hitting 755 home runs and a fabulous career with the Braves and the Brewers. Also, Elston Howard, who, by the way, became the first black player on the Yankees. This was back in the 60s. He wound up playing on several pennant-winning teams from 1955 until 58, and then again from 60 to 64. And he became the first black catcher. Well, not the first black catcher, but the first black catcher to play for the Yankees was Elston Howard. He wound up playing 12 and a half of his 13 years with the Yankees and then became a successful coach on the Yankees until he passed away in 1980. Once upon a time, the sport of baseball wound up being a major hit in the African-American community because of guys like Jackie and Willie Mays, and later on guys like Willie Stargell and Reggie Jackson and Dave Winfield. But now, it's become a chore to try and steer young black kids into playing baseball, because it's gotten to the point where they're either playing basketball or football, or they're not playing any sports and they're just spending a lot of time playing video games. It is critical that we try to make our way into the African American community and try and teach these kids how to play baseball, because it has become almost non-existent in the African American community to see these kids even talk baseball, much less play it. So, with that said, I'm going to keep the topic on baseball for a little bit and talk about how the spring training circuit wound up beginning just last week. The Mets started off first, exactly 1 week ago today to be exact, while the Yankees started off the following day. And as it turns out, the Mets wound up getting some pitching help to start the spring because they signed Jason Vargas to a two-year deal. Now, granted, Jason Vargas is not a spectacular signing. Keep in mind, Lance Lynn and also John Lackey and also Jake Arrieta are three well-known pitchers who still do not have any jobs whatsoever. So you look at the numbers that Jason Vargas has put up. I mean, they're not terrible. 85-81 record, 4.17 ERA in 248 career games. But he's only had five winning seasons in 13 years. Last year was his best season. He set a career high with 18 victories. At the same time, you kind of wish that the Mets would probably do a little bit more of a splash when it comes to trying to get somebody who can make an impact. I mean, it's not terrible. Jason Vargas is a decent pitcher. And you put him in there with the other guys that the Mets have, DeGrom, Syndergaard, Harvey, Steven Matz, Zach Wheeler. There's also Robert Gsellman and Seth Lugo to consider. That's potentially eight starters that the Mets have to try and work into five spots. So the Mets aren't necessarily doing a terrible job. I mean, they've been able to fill some holes, and they did get that one pitcher that they were looking for. Granted, not somebody who's very flashy, but at the same time, at least the Mets are trying to put themselves in the right direction. And you also consider who some of their returning starters are going to be. Matt Harvey looks like he's doing really well for himself. The one guy that's been getting a lot of the attention is Noah Syndergaard. If you've seen him on television during workouts in Port St. Lucie, he looks so chiseled and so physically powerful. He looks like he might be in for a really, really big season. And you also consider they have a whole new coaching staff that they're trying to work in. They now have Dave Island, who once pitched for the Yankees over 30 years ago, and he already has made his mark as a pitching coach with the Royals, having led them to a pair of pennants and a championship with a really solid staff. And now he's going to try and work his magic with this Mets staff as we speak. And when you think about it, you consider their starters and also who is going to be in the bullpen. Could it be that the Mets might be able to set themselves up, if not for a division title, then maybe for one of those two wild cards? I would think so. Let's just see if these guys can keep their good health, because four out of their five starters wound up missing a huge chunk of time last year. And there's still the matter of Michael Conforto, who's not going to be back until May because of his shoulder surgery. And I already heard one thing where he might have had a setback in his rehab from shoulder surgery. They're going to try and poo-poo it, but at the same time, shoulder surgeries are really, really delicate things to try and take care of. So let's see what the Mets are going to do, or let's see what the Mets have done with their rehab. As for the Yankees, they continue to raise expectations among themselves to try and get to that next level this year. Last year, they really took people by surprise by going the distance in the American League Championship Series. Now, they have really raised the bar to the point where they might be the team to beat. Although, if you ask Justin Verlander of the Astros, it's the Astros that are still the team to beat because they're the defending champions. And they wound up adding Gerrit Cole to their pitching staff. So when you think about it, I don't want to say that this is a two-team race, but right now the Astros and the Yankees are the two teams that other squads might have to go through in the American League. I think the Red Sox are not going to be terrible, but they might be in for a down season. They had a couple of guys missing a chunk of time because of injuries. So let's see exactly what happens with the Red Sox this year. I still expect Cleveland to be better. Detroit might be taking some people by surprise. I think Minnesota is going to be better. The American League West, look out for the Los Angeles Angels of Anaheim. I really misjudged them as far as their personnel moves were concerned, but they really did a lot to improve that pitching staff, and they also got much better on the infield. So let's see how this American League shapes up after the Astros and the Yankees. As far as the rest of the National League, I mentioned that the Mets are really looking to try and make a run this year. Right now, the Eastern Division strictly goes through Washington because Washington has been the defending champions in that division the last couple of years. And somewhere down the line, they're going to have to win a playoff series because if not, could this be the time that maybe the Nationals blow things up, a.k.a. seeing Bryce Harper leave for greener pastures? Who knows? And you also look at how the rest of that league, how the rest of the division is. Atlanta's building with some young players. Phillies is building with young players. They're going to be dangerous in the next couple of years. I don't know what's going on with Miami. They've traded one star after another. It seems like they're in rebuilding mode every single season. And because of that, Derek Jeter, who's now the majority owner of the Marlins, has gotten roasted by fans and media in South Florida. As for the Central Division, could this be the year that we see the Chicago Cubs take a fall from grace? Even though they brought in Yu Darvish, there's still no sign of whether they're going to bring back Jake Arrieta or not. I mean, Darvish is going to help. He had a rather up and down 2017, but maybe a change of scenery will help him out a little bit. Cincinnati and Pittsburgh, I think, are rebuilding. St. Louis is going to be dangerous. Milwaukee is going to be really, really dangerous this year, what with all of the additions that they made. Easily the most competitive division in baseball this year is the National League West. The Diamondbacks, Rockies, Dodgers, and Giants all got better over the course of the season. And it could be that either one of those four teams might win the West this year. It's not going to be the Padres. The Padres continue to rebuild every single season. Now, it's All-Star break time in the NBA. They had the All-Star game just last night, and it was different this time because instead of the usual Eastern Conference versus Western Conference, they had the two captains for the game choosing sides to see who they wanted as part of their All-Star teams. Now, as far as the season itself resuming, they had the rookie game, they had the three-point shootout and the skills challenge. This time, it's going to be a matter of when the season resumes. The season officially is going to resume this coming Thursday night, the 22nd, when the Nets take on the Hornets and the Knicks play the Magic. Speaking of the Nets and Knicks, I know the Nets have been rebuilding with some young players, and Sean Marks, for the better part, has done a respectable job with some of the guys that he's brought in, bringing in Isaiah Whitehead and Caris LeVert and Rondae Hollis-Jefferson, three really good young players that the Nets can try and build with for the future. At the same time, well, and also bringing in Allen Crabbe and Damari Carroll from the scrap heap. At the same time, though, how much longer do Brooklyn Nets fans really have to wait in order for to see this team be taken seriously? They're 21 games under 500 at the All-Star break right now. Somewhere down the line, Sean Marks is really going to have to wave his magic wand and try and pull off a deal to try and bring in some kind of impact player, either because it doesn't seem like the draft is going to be of any help to them. They don't have a number one draft pick this year, so it's looking more and more like Sean Marks is going to try and work his magic to see if he can cut a deal to make this team really better. As for the Knicks, let's put it this way. They have now lost 22 of their last 31 games, including 8 in a row. The more this team flops, especially in the fourth quarters of games, the more that they're proving my point that as long as that creep owner continues to run the show, that franchise will never be worth anything. Doesn't matter what they are worth financially. As far as the competitive landscape in the NBA, they will continue to be looked down upon as a laughingstock. And this is why they really have to start grabbing the bull by the horns and start convincing some of these free agents to make their way over here. Scott Perry has probably his first full summer to try and cut a deal with someone. And when you think about it, their backcourt play has stunk. Their point guard play, no one knows what the hell they're doing. And with Kristaps Porzingis now out for the rest of this season and probably the first half of next year after tearing up his knee, that franchise has nowhere to go but down. At this rate, they might have maybe the 9th or 10th overall pick in the draft, and that is not going to get them any kind of impact player whatsoever. In a draft that might have either Marvin Bagley III or Mo Bamba or Trey Young or any of the other freshmen that are going to be making their way into the draft in June, there is no chance in hell that the Knicks will be able to land any of those young kids. If anything, they might want to consider getting themselves a guy, maybe a two-way player, small forward slash shooting guard, who can really light up the scoreboard for them, because it's going to be forever before Kristaps Porzingis is healthy again. And you see some of the guys that are either in their walk years or have options on their contracts. Maybe it's about time that the Knicks start cutting their losses and start building with some younger players, because it's painfully obvious no superstar wants to play here. As much as they want to try and convince some that there are some guys that want to play in New York, let's put it this way. LeBron James has rejected the Knicks twice. Kevin Durant has rejected the Knicks once. No other superstar with even one quarter of a brain is going to ever even fathom wanting to play in this market. Wherever LeBron James goes, some of the superstars are going to follow. Wherever Steph Curry is, in all likelihood Oakland, the superstars are going to follow. Klay Thompson, who's going to be a free agent soon, he made it loud and clear he will only play for the Warriors. And it's gotten to the point where we could only see teams that are this close to being a contender probably landing a superstar right now. Just recently, I wound up seeing this video about 10 places that would be best suited for LeBron James to go to try and win a championship. And I saw a list that included the Denver Nuggets and the Phoenix Suns and the New Orleans Pelicans. First off, LeBron will never go to New Orleans because, for one, New Orleans is a dreadful market for basketball. And number two, do Anthony Davis and DeMarcus Cousins and Drew Holiday really want to share the ball with a guy who's so high maintenance and commands so much of the ball that the other guys might want to be not necessarily ousted, but maybe phased out of the offense? And the thing is, LeBron has had a reputation for being a little too unselfish. If anything, he's not selfish enough because he defers to teammates too often. New Orleans is not the place for LeBron. Neither is Phoenix. Phoenix has zero impact players that could try and make any sense for the next couple of seasons. The one kid that they have right now, Devin Booker, is probably the only young player who's actually worth a damn. There's also Denver. Denver is building something interesting, but would LeBron James want to go to Denver? I don't think so. Then you have the two teams in L.A. Why would LeBron James want to be a Los Angeles Clipper? The Clippers are already in rebuilding mode. They traded Chris Paul and Blake Griffin in the span of 7 months. DeAndre Jordan is going to be a free agent at the end of the year. Does anybody in their right mind think that LeBron wants to go to a rebuilding situation like the Clippers? I don't think so. The hot rumor is the Lakers. When you think about it, the Lakers are the team that has the most history. They also have the better crop of young players with Lonzo Ball and Brandon Ingram and Julius Randle. Maybe LeBron might be able to mentor these young men if he decides to go to the Lakers. I also heard the Celtics. Why would LeBron ever want to go to his arch enemy? LeBron has killed the Celtics in the past, and the Celtics have killed LeBron in the past. That rivalry will never go away. LeBron is not going to the Celtics. And you can forget about him ever making his way to the New York area. He has zero interest in trying to be on a rebuilding squad. LeBron wants to win a championship. Now, the two teams that might make the most sense, his current team, the Cavaliers, and possibly Houston. Houston has James Harden and Chris Paul, two superstars that LeBron has been really clamoring quietly to work with. LeBron is really tight with Chris Paul. I would even see two dark horse candidates, if you ask me. One is his former team, the Miami Heat. Even though Dwayne Wade wound up getting traded back to South Florida, don't be surprised if you see a possible reunion with D. Wade in South Florida. And there's even another team that you might want to consider as a potential dark horse. Oklahoma City. They already have three legit stars that LeBron can probably defer the ball to if he's not demanding the ball. Paul George, Carmelo Anthony, both of whom he has been really wanting to work with more often in the past, and Russell Westbrook. You put those four in the same starting lineup, Oklahoma City could probably win 55 to 60 games a season. Now, after this season ends, what's going to be the future of Melo and Paul George? There's still the rumor of Paul George going to the Lakers. All of a sudden, he's waffling on what he wants to do. One moment he says he would see himself spending the rest of his career working with Russell Westbrook. The next moment he says he doesn't even know where he wants to go. Something's got to give. Somewhere down the line, he's got to make a decision. As far as what's going on with the rest of the NBA, you look at the Eastern Conference right now. Who saw Toronto being in the top spot in the East? Of course, that's going to change because right now, Toronto has played less games than the second-place team in the league, which is Boston. But Toronto has played such good basketball lately. They've won three in a row. Before that, they were slumping, but they've won their last three games. And you consider Kyle Lowry and DeMar DeRozan a real dangerous duo. DeMar DeRozan is probably the franchise player that the Raptors have long been looking for. And Kyle Lowry is the steady point guard that any NBA team should be able to work with and build around. After that, you got Cleveland. Now that they made the trades to get Jordan Clarkson, Larry Nance Jr., Rodney Hood, George Hill, on paper, they've gotten themselves better. George Hill is a really steady point guard. Jordan Clarkson is a kid who can score in bunches. Larry Nance Jr. is a very good role player. Rodney Hood, an underrated player who can fill a role very, very nicely on a team. They've only won a couple of games recently, but in the long run, there's only 23 games left in the season, roughly, for each of the teams. Could this be the time that maybe the Cavaliers make a really big run to reclaim the top spot in the Eastern Conference? Quite possibly. Right now, the three teams that should be considered very, very seriously to go to the finals are Cleveland, Toronto, and Boston. After that, Washington is very up and down. Milwaukee, I don't trust with my life. If anything, Giannis Antetokounmpo really should think about leaving Milwaukee and try to go somewhere else, because he just does not have the superstars in Milwaukee that he can try and work with to go really, really far and to the next level. Granted, he's got a couple of good players. He's got Chris Middleton, and now he has Eric Bledsoe, who can get him the ball all the time. But after that, Milwaukee has very, very little to try and work with. After that, Detroit had a five-game winning streak, but they've sputtered a little bit since the Blake Griffin trade. Don't be surprised if you see them make a push for one of those last spots. Look out for Miami. Now that Dwayne Wade is back, that young team, which was already having a solid season to work with, might be a little bit more energized the rest of the way. And they say in Philadelphia, trust the process. Well, maybe, just maybe, if these guys, these young players, can keep their good health in order, just maybe they might be able to make a serious run for the rest of the regular season. As far as the playoffs are concerned, tell you what, if they had a healthy Markel Fultz and he was able to grasp the offense a little bit, maybe the Sixers could be taken a little bit more seriously. But now, Fultz is hurt. Ben Simmons has had to play more of the point forward role, while Joel Embiid continues to put up monster numbers. And it's not just those two guys either. There's TJ McConnell, there's JJ Redick, both of whom have been really solid this season. And also they made the trade to get Trevor Booker from the Brooklyn Nets. Booker has been very good for them in a supporting role. Trust the process? I think the process is already starting to get a lot of followers right now. Other than that, I don't see anyone in the Eastern Conference that can challenge Boston, Cleveland, or Toronto. The Eastern Conference is going to run through those three teams right now. As for the West, I don't know what there is to say about Golden State that has not already been said. Golden State is just magnificent. They shoot the three well, they defend, they're just deadly in transition. A lot of people say maybe Houston is the one that could give Golden State a run for their money. Houston's played well, but for some reason, I just don't see them matching up with them defensively the way a team like probably Boston could. San Antonio is another team that should not be taken lightly. In spite of the fact that LaMarcus Aldridge has been a disappointment for them, some of the other role players that they have might be able to make a contribution for them. As far as anything else, well, I would possibly look out for Utah because they're smoking right now. I would look out for Denver. I would also look out for Minnesota. The young players that they have, coupled with Jimmy Butler, they're going to be really dangerous in the first round for somebody. So right now, Golden State is the team to beat, but Houston, Utah, Minnesota, San Antonio, those are the four teams to watch in the Western Conference. As far as the NHL is concerned, I hate to say this, but I think it might be time to pull the plug on the Rangers as it is, because they have sputtered so badly and have been such a disappointment that maybe it is about time to try and make a deal for a few of their veteran players. Because you look at them right now, they're in 11th place in the Eastern Conference. They're four games out of that last spot, which right now is occupied by Carolina. As for the Islanders, they're a point out of that last spot, but they're in 10th place. Something has got to be done with John Tavares and his future, because he's going to be an unrestricted free agent at the end of the year. He's made it loud and clear he wants to be an Islander. It's just a matter of trying to get a deal together. Excuse me. Right now, the only team that seems to be making a real push for a couple of those last spots is the Devils. And right now, they're tied with Philly for that seventh spot. So maybe the Devils would be the one to represent the Eastern Conference, or represent the tri-state area in the Eastern Conference. Right now, Tampa is the team to beat in the Eastern Conference. Out in the West, the Las Vegas Golden Knights, the expansion Vegas Golden Knights, continue to defy all logic and lead the West by 3 points over the next closest competitors, which just so happened to be Nashville. Right now, Vegas and Nashville and probably Winnipeg would be the three teams to watch for in that Western Conference as far as playoffs and the Stanley Cup Finals is concerned. And I just got word that unfortunately there was a serious situation involving one of the Yankee prospects. Tairo Estrada, who is an infield prospect, was the victim of a robbery recently, and he wound up getting shot in the thigh. But they're expecting him to be okay, so hopefully he'll be able to make a quick recovery. So, with that said, we're just going to call it right here. But before I officially sign off, I want to give a thanks to Roman DeSimone, who's on the other side of the glass. And I also want to say thanks to you guys for watching at home. And I also want to say, keep my friend Hector Boza in your prayers. So please, send him a get well message on his Facebook page. And in case you missed the show, you can check us out on both our YouTube page, which is under my name, Jaime Hixson, or you can check it out under the show's name, which is In the Bleachers. So for everyone here, I'm Jaime. We hope you enjoy the rest of your President's Day evening, and we also hope to see you next Monday night. Good night, everyone.